Doctor. Chris Emmett and Mike Newman, Carol and Dusty Bin, and the 3-2-1 girl.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for that wonderful welcome. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. And for all of you people that weren't applauding, I've got something that you can do with your hands. Now, guess what it is?
3, 2, 1.
Well, you didn't rehearse that very well, did you? Very easy, really. Bomb, bomb, bomb. And I tell you what, for you people in the studio audience, while you're doing that with one hand, try applauding with the other hand. Go on, try. Go on. Louder, I can't hear you. Louder. Well, as usual, folks, we've got some very interesting parties in our audience. For instance, just here we've got a group of people who live near London Airport, and they complain about the noise. They're suffragettes. Over here, we've got a couple of new pop groups. First of all, there's Phil Landra and the Conquests. Behind them, we've got Stretch Marks and the Arrivals. Now, over here, we've got a group of Avon ladies who are complaining they're losing money because of a new council estate. All the front doors have got knockers. And there's a gentleman over here from Alcoholics Anonymous, and a bit later on, he'll be giving a talk on how drinking can affect the memory. He'll be giving a talk on how drinking can affect the memory. He'll be giving a talk on how drinking can affect... Also, we have a party of people who are going to a fancy dress ball. First of all, they're going as famous people. There's a French bell ringer, a Venetian traveller, there's a Russian dancer, an Italian lover, a Dickens character, an Elizabethan sailor, a royal ruler, a lady poisoner, a Portuguese explorer, the Tibetan leader, a songwriter, a Shakespeare player, a Roman emperor, a smiling poser, an Egyptian raver, and the Prime Minister. That's Quasimodo, Marco Polo, Anna Pavlova, Casanova, Jacob Marley, Walter Raleigh, Queen Victoria, Lucrezia Borgia, Vasco da Gama, Dalai Lama, Ivan Novello, Anne Othello, Julius Caesar, Mona Lisa, Cleopatra, Maggie Thatcher. They're right here. Well, as usual, it's our Dolly Dustman and our Telly Tin Man, Karen Palmer, and our Booby Prize. Now, how is he this week, Karen?
Well, you know, Ted, it's all these shows that affected him. He's beginning to crack, so I've had to call help.
A doctor?
No, silly, a welder.
Well, listen, that metal fatigue's affecting everybody, even the $6 million man. He's now only worth $2 million. And that's a scrap. So anybody wins him, remember, they take home a brand new dustbin. So, Karen, take Dusty away.
Right.
We'll see the pair of you a bit later on. There goes. Right, folks, the most important people are here tonight, our contestants who are going to play 3-2-1. So, will you please greet them now?
David Wallace from Rednal in Worcestershire.
Mike Apollo, Brenda and Graham Morrison from Ponteland in Northumberland.
This is Rosemary and Chris Johnson from Washingboro in Lincolnshire.
Thank you, Murray. So here we have Chris and Rosemary Johnson from Lincoln. Now, Chris, you've got rather a different job, haven't you, really, from most people? You're an archivist?
That's right, yes. We collect and look after interesting historical documents.
Oh, you mean like scripts for the comedians?
Something like that.
Oh, no, even you couldn't look after documents that old, let's be fair. No, so tell us a little about it. What do you do exactly?
Well, our service is run by the County Council in Lincolnshire, and we, as I said, we're collecting these documents, and people from all walks of life come in to look at them.
Oh, that's a very interesting job, I must say. Now, Rosemary, you don't work these days, of course, but you do have some hobbies, don't you?
Yes, philately.
Philately?
Yes.
Now, that's an interesting hobby for a lady, surely. It's a lot of men, I always find, that collect stamps. Do you specialise, or is there many stamps you collect? Or...
No, I collect most countries, but I have more French and English ones.
Really?
Yes.
You know, they're bringing out a stamp pretty soon for critics.
Are they?
Yes, it's not going to be perforated. No, they pin the holes in them themselves. So, let's have the questions with the girl in question this week, Annie St. John. How are you, Annie?
I'm fine now, Ted.
And how's the car? You've had trouble with the car?
Oh, yes. No, it's all fixed.
Is it?
Yes, but I think I'll travel by bus in future.
Why is that?
Well, there are some terrible drivers on the road. They're absolutely terrible. This week, I've been involved in accidents with 5 of them.
It's your own fault for taking that crash course. Thanks very much, indeed. Well, ladies and gentlemen, our couples have chosen 1 of 3 envelopes at random, so either of them could have any set of questions. As you know by now, in our quiz, we like our couples to answer alternately. That's ladies first, of course, all right? In the first round, there's 3 ways they can be stopped: if they make a mistake, if they repeat an answer, or indeed if the time runs out. That's when they hear from you-know-who, one of our comedians. This week, Mr. Chris Emmett.
Good evening. Here is the news.
In Nuneaton today, Mr. Mike Wormald, a keen gardener, appeared in court on a drugs charge. Last year he planted a cherry stone and a tree came up. Then he planted some apple seeds and an orchard came up. This year he planted some cannabis and the police came up.
Right, if you, as you're playing for £10 for each correct answer in the first round, we want you to give all 10 answers. We don't give you one to start with in this round, but if you score 10, of course, you'd have 100. That's well on the way to 1,000. We do hope you do well. Good luck to you for £10 for each correct answer. We want the objects which are recommended by the motoring organisations which you should carry in your car for use in emergencies. Now, we'll give you an example. First aid box, but you must not use that. So, objects for use in emergencies you have in the car now.
Spare wheel.
Fire extinguisher.
Screwdriver.
A warning triangle.
Spanner.
Can cause a lot of trouble, you know. Oh, yes. The woman next door to me is suing for divorce. She reckons her husband loves his car more than her. With very good reason. She found traces of dipstick on his collar. A dipstick.
Well, you ran out of time there, Chris and Rosemary. There were a few more you could have said, like towing rope, jack, jump leads, wheel brace. But anyway, how did we do with it, Annie? How did we do?
Rosemary and Chris scored 5, so they have £50.
Well, £50. That's good. That's not a bad start, £50. Now we've got Graham and Brenda from Ponteland. Not Ponteland, Ponteland.
That's right.
Up in Northumberland. Now, Graham, it says here that you're a civil engineer, so you won't be rude when I talk to you, will you? You won't.
No,
now, what sort of things are you doing up there in Geordieland?
Well, I work on the Newcastle-upon-Tyne Metro, which is...
A metro?
Which is...
Like London?
Yeah, and there's one in Glasgow as well.
Yeah, I've been on the one in Glasgow. I didn't know you were making one in Newcastle. I should have known that.
It's a very large one.
It's going to be bigger than the Glasgow one, is it?
Oh, yes, because it's about 25 to 30 miles long.
Newcastle Metro.
Yeah.
Won't meet up with the Metro in Paris. That would be nice, wouldn't it? It'd
be a good idea,
yeah.
Save that. It might take rather a long time.
Save all that airport chaos. Brenda, you're a full-time housewife, are you, or not?
No, I'm part-time.
Part-time
secretary for a firm of quantity surveyors.
Quantity surveyors, yeah. I was a quantity surveyor once. Every day I looked at how fat I was getting. Anyway, do you have any hobbies? That's what I want.
Yes, I sketch and life drawing.
Really?
Yes.
My brother's an artist, you know. He specialises in sketching government buildings. Last week he drew the doll. Let's have the questions from Annie. Thank you very much, Annie. OK, so good luck to you. You've got £50 to beat at the moment. You're going for £10 for each correct answer. We want the names of organised sport in this country in which a ball is deliberately hit by a player using an object made partially or entirely of wood. Now, we'll give you an example, tennis, but you must not use that. So, sports using a ball and wooden objects now.
Squash.
Hockey.
Cricket.
Badminton.
And now here is the sports news. At a national angling competition held today at Blackpool, a one-armed fisherman caught a fish this big.
Well, Graham and Brenda, there was a mistake there. You said we wanted a ball being hit by a piece of wood. Or a wooden object. You did say badminton. Well, of course, that's a shuttlecock. It's not a ball. So it was a mistake there. So, Annie, how did they do?
Well, Brenda and Graham got 3, so they have £30.
£30, yeah. That's pretty good. And here we've got David and Pat, and you're from Rednall, Worcestershire, yes?
That's correct, yes.
Now, David, what sort of work do you do?
I'm a detective sergeant with the West Midlands Police.
Oh. You brought your fan club with you. Oh, a policeman. So you're a member of the Law and Order Licensed Officers Legal Organisation, or as it's better known, LOLOLO. I've often entertained the police, you know. Oh, yeah. Oh, many is the time I've blown them a tune on the old breathalyzer. Afterwards, the inspector wanted me for a show. He said to the sergeant, book him. Anyway. Now, Pat, I mean, with David out of the house so many different hours, all hours of the day, what do you do to pass the time?
Well, I just made wine. Made some wine.
Make some wine?
Mm-hmm.
What sort of wine would a policeman make? GBH, genuine blue bottle hock. Oh. How about prune wine? That'll be good for running them in, wouldn't it? Anyhow, let's have the questions, please, for Annie. Thank you very much indeed, Annie. Okay, we've got a 50 and a 30 to beat, and you're going for £10. Here we go. Good luck. We want metric units which are used in everyday life once we go metric. Now, we'll give you an example, kilometre, but you must not use that. So, metric units used in everyday life now.
Millimetre.
Gram.
Stones.
Following the introduction of metric measurement to this country, a government spokesman said that we should now use the meter everywhere, as it seems more logical to do so. And to help the public, an office will be set up. It will be called the Meter Logical Office. The Meter Logical Office! Yes! Yes!
Shame on you, sir. Well, I'm afraid, Pat, you did make a mistake there. You said stones, huh? Well, no, that's not metric, unfortunately. There were just a few more, like meter, liter, metric, tone, I think that's how you say, or ton, T-O-N-N-E, square meter, centimeter, but Annie, how did they score?
Well, Pat and David only got 2, I'm afraid, so they have £20.
So, at the end of the first round, what do we have? We've got David and Pat on £20. In the centre here, we've got Brenda and Graham on £30, but in the lead at the moment, Chris and Rosemary, £50. All right, this time you're going for £50 for each correct answer. Thank you, Annie, for the more difficult rounds of questioning. Now, here, it's slightly different. There are only 2 ways they can be stopped this round. That's if they make a mistake or if they run out of time. We still want you to answer alternately, all right? But this time, I'll ask you the questions individually, and if you don't know an answer, say don't know, and I'll go on to your partner with the next question. So good luck to you. And we are going to give you one to start with this time. This question, it's a pleasure, it's about members of the current British Cabinet. You're going to tell me you didn't even vote for them, right. We'll give you the post. We want you to give us the name of the holder. Now, the Employment Secretary is James Pryor, so that's the one I'll give you to start with. Employment Secretary, James Pryor. Number 2, Home Secretary.
Don't know.
Number 3, Prime Minister.
Margaret Thatcher.
Number 4, Foreign Secretary.
Don't know.
5, Industry Secretary.
Don't know.
6, Chancellor of the Exchequer.
How?
7, Environment Secretary.
Don't know.
8, Minister of Arts.
Don't know.
9, Northern Ireland Secretary.
Don't know.
10, Energy Secretary.
Don't know.
Hello, shipmates. You know, a lot of people say I'm not in the cabinet because I don't get on with Mrs. Thatcher and her colleagues. Well, that simply isn't true. Absolute nonsense. And to show what a good sport I am, next week I'm going to sail my yacht from Dover to Calais and ask Mrs. Thatcher and the cabinet to line the route.
Well, Chris and Rosemary, there were a few you didn't know there. The Home Secretary is Willie Whitelaw. The Foreign Secretary is Lord Carrington. The Industry Secretary is Sir Keith Joseph. 7th, the Environment Secretary is Michael Heseltine. Minister for the Arts, Norman St. John Stevens. Northern Ireland Secretary, Humphrey Atkins. And Energy Secretary, David Howell. So how did they do, Annie?
Chris and Rosemary got 3 correct answers, so they have £150.
Thank you, Annie. And Graham and Brenda are on £30 for each correct answer. Well, if you could get 10 threes, would be £300, wouldn't it? Very, very good. Let's see how well you're going to get on. Good luck. This question is about sportsmen and women who have excelled in one sport in particular. Now, we'll give you the name of the sport in which that person is most closely associated. Pat Smythe, of course, was known for show jumping, so I'll start you with that one. Pat Smythe and show jumping. Right. Number 2, Jack Beresford. Graham?
Don't know.
No, number 3, Bruce McLaren.
Motor racing.
Number 4, Larissa Latinina.
Don't know.
Number 5, Jeff Duke.
Don't know.
Number 6, Johnny Weissmuller.
Swimming.
Number 7, Fred Perry.
Tennis.
Number 8, De Beaumont.
Don't know.
Number 9, Wally Grubb.
My favourite sport, swimming. And last week, I met a lovely girl at the swimming baths. Oh, I did fancy her. I took her out several times, but it was no good. She kept diving back.
Well, Graham and Brenda, you ran out of time, and again, there were a few you didn't know there. Jack Beresford, of course, was rowing. Larissa Latinina was gymnastics. Fred Perry. Oh, you got Fred Perry. Yes, you did. Jeff Duke was motorcycling, and De Beaumont was fencing. So, Annie, how did they score?
Brenda and Graham scored 4, so they have £120.
£120. Thank you, Annie. So here we have the second set of questions for David and Pat on £20 for each correct answer. And good luck to you. This question is about monarchs and their consorts. We will give you the name of a ruling British king or queen, and we want you to give us the name of his or her consort. Now, William the Fourth was married to Adelaide, so we'll start you with that. William the Fourth and Adelaide. Two, George the Fifth.
Don't know.
Three, Victoria.
And
four, Anne. And
don't know.
Five, George the Sixth.
Elizabeth.
Six, Edward the Seventh.
Don't know.
Seven, Charles the First.
I don't know.
Eight, George the Third.
Don't know.
Nine, Elizabeth the Second.
Philip.
Ten, James the First of England and Sixth of Scotland.
The famous portrait of Queen Victoria, which was sold recently for nearly £1 million, has today left the country and from now on is part of an American collection. This is reputed to be the world's biggest art transplant.
Transplant, yes!
Well, Pat and David, there were a few you didn't know there. George V, of course, it was Mary, Anne, George of Denmark, Edward VII and Alexandria, Charles I, Henrietta Maria, and George III, Charlotte. Would you believe? So, Annie, how did they do?
David and Pat answered 5, so they have £100.
£100. So, at the end of the quiz, what have we got? We've got David and Pat on £100. We have Brenda and Graham on £120. But the winners of the quiz this week, yes, we have Rosemary and Chris, £150 they've got. That means, unfortunately, we have to say goodbye to you, David and Pat, right here and now, but you will stick around and enjoy the rest of the show, I hope. Yes. There's Karen with your £100.
Thank you.
There's your ceramic dusty bin.
Lovely.
Now, you know what they like to get a hold of. Gold dust, right?
Thank
Congratulations.
You.
Haven't they been a lovely couple, folks? Thank you. Well, folks, we're going away just for a couple of minutes. We'll be back soon on 3-2-1. Don't go too far away, will you? Welcome to part two, ladies and gentlemen, where our remaining couples are about to play the elimination game. Now, the theme of the show this week is hotels, and our game is called the Spaghetti Waiters Training School. Now, have a look at this. As you can see, each of our couples has a table on which are plates and forks. In the middle, there is a slide. And at the end of the slide, there is a second table. Now, on the first whistle, we want the ladies to run to the table, pick up a plate and a fork, run up the stairs, slide down the slide. When you get to the bottom of the slide, the fellows will spray on some spaghetti onto the plate, like that. Good stuff, that, isn't it? Now, you take the plate, put it onto the table, and you keep that process going until the second whistle blows. Then the fellows take over. You go and get the plates. Ladies, you spray the spaghetti. On the third whistle, we'll stop, and, of course, the couples with the most plates on the table will go through to part three and have a chance of winning one of our fabulous prizes tonight. So, you all know what you have to do? Yes? Yep. All right, would you like to go to your places, please? That's it. Get on your spot. Karen is here with a whistle. Make sure everybody's in place and all set. Yes? Okay, good luck to you all. 3, 2, 1. Fellas, come on, you go and get those plates. Up the stairs, down the slide. Whoops! Ladies, you spray the spaghetti. Come round here. Oh, my. It's more like the Krypton Factor assault course, that, wasn't it? Well done, Grandma. I thought you were going to break it in two then. My goodness. Anyway, collecting yourself. Fine. Let's see how you did. Murray, how did your couple do?
My couple scored six.
Six they got. Very good. Very good indeed. And what about you? That's nice. How about your couple, Jenny?
Well, my couple scored five.
Five. Just one in it. Oh, dear. Well, congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations. That means you go to through to our next part where you're going to have a chance to win one of the big prizes or the booby prize. Don't forget that. Unfortunately, we have to say goodbye at this point to Graham and Brenda, who've been a terrific couple. What did they win in the quiz?
£120.
£120. There's your ceramic dusty bin too. And, of course, your photo frame. And the photograph has been taken of you during the show, as you know. That'll be in the post in a couple of days or so. Thank you so much,
Thank
Brenda.
You.
Take care. Thank you, Graham. Weren't they nice, folks? Off you go. Well, we come this way. Here we are. Now then, if we can have you sort of reversed. Rosemary, would you like to come around this side here? That's it. And Chris, you can stand just in there, nice and tight, so we can get a nice picture of you. You've got your breath back here? That was pretty tough, wasn't it, for an archivist? My goodness. Well, you know what happens here, don't you? This is where we really get to the point of the show where you really have to start thinking, because, as you know, we have five sketches and we have five prizes. Four terrific ones. We may or may not have a car on the show this week. That's up to you to try and figure out, but you know that we're going to have Dusty Bin, huh?
Yes.
Win him, you've got yourself a brand new dustbin. Now, at the end of every sketch, one of the characters will come over here, leave a clue object. They'll read you a rhyme which will definitely be a clue. Now, when you've got three on the table, I shall ask you to reject one. When you've rejected four in all, the one remaining will be the prize that determines what you take home with you tonight, all right? Good, so we'll have our first sketch right now. As I say, the theme of our show is hotels. Now, I've stayed at hotels all around the world, and of course they do vary, you know, from country to country. I've never forgot I got to a Cairo hotel, it was terrible. Really bad, I asked them to move me to something more comfortable, a pyramid. It was that bad, you've been, haven't you? When I was in Hong Kong once, and the telephone went, he said, would you like loom service? Well, I had to laugh. I said, yes, please. 2 minutes later, a fella came up with a wooden machine and made me three shirts. This is the place. I got to Leeds. I've never forgotten this one here, honestly. The room was so bad, I complained about the sheets. I said to the manager, it looks as though this bed's been slept in. He said, it couldn't have been. This is the bridal suite. Anyway, our sketch, let's say you're going to have a good look at it, because meeting people, whether by design or accident, that's what happens at a hotel.
I do love you so. If only my husband understood me the way that you do.
If only my wife had your tenderness and compassion.
Oh, I'm so nervous. I've never done this before. Do you think anyone might see us?
Oh, don't worry. No one ever comes to this hotel.
Okay, that's it. Women and children.
No. Have you got a double room with a bath?
Oh, a double room, yes, sir. Do you want a plug with it?
Why, is it electric?
I'm afraid all our rooms only have gas.
Gas?
Yes, gas, madam. I feel that electricity is just a passing fit.
How am I going to work my hairdryer?
Hairdryer? You didn't have to bring a hairdryer.
Well, I know it's a silly habit, but every time my husband and I go to a hotel, he does so appreciate the care I take of my hair.
Yes, but now the room must be vacated by 12 noon.
Oh, don't worry, we'll be out in an hour.
An hour?
Yeah, well, I've got an important appointment later. I can't waste the entire afternoon.
Waste the entire afternoon? My husband doesn't think I'm a waste of time.
No, darling, I didn't say
that. It sounds as if we're going to a sales meeting. Will there be someone in there taking notes?
Can I have your names, please?
Smith.
Jones.
We agreed on Smith.
No, we didn't. We said Jones.
No, we said Jones, but then we changed it to Smith because you have a maiden aunt called Jones. It's Mr. and Mrs. Smith hyphen Jones. Double barrel, you see.
Double barrel, yes. Can I have your Christian names, please?
John.
David.
John hyphen David.
I see. John hyphen David hyphen Smith hyphen Jones, is that it?
Smith hyphen Jones,
oh,
yes.
Oh, Smith hyphen Jones.
That's correct, yes.
How?
What's the matter?
It's my husband.
Oh, no, quick, the disguises.
Quick. husband. I made a mistake.
You made a mistake? Well, I've heard about your husband since we got here.
Don't you talk to... There's nothing wrong with my husband. At least he doesn't go around wearing a woman's wig.
At least my wife doesn't wear a moustache. Cancel the room. I'll just take the bath.
Do you want running water?
Of course.
Running water?
That's what I call room service.
We've got to stop meeting like this.
Oh, it's lovely, though.
Anna, how are you, love? All right?
Very well, darling.
Good. Now, what's going to be the clue this week?
That.
Ah, a piece of chalk.
That's right.
A piece of chalk is the clue for you. Now, this is Anna, Chris, Rosemary.
Hello, hello.
Would you like to read the rhyme for them?
Yes, I'd love to. This could be the start of something. You may get carried away. If you're stopping at a 4-star, you'll impress the staff this way.
Now, any ideas on that straight away?
Probably a holiday. And they said waste in their thing, a waste of time. So
Well, they're thinking about it already, which is nice. Ladies and gentlemen,
yeah.
Anna Dawson. Thanks, sweetheart. Carried away could be the dustbin,
could,
yes? But you mentioned something about a holiday, didn't you?
It could
a holiday.
Be that too,
yeah.
Yes.
we do get very, very devious, you know that,
you
don't
do,
you?
Yes.
Well, let's have another sketch and see what you make of this one. You know, you may not believe this, but there are hotels like Forty Towers. Take my word, I stayed at one once. It was called Cripping Grange. The room service was so bad, in the morning I ordered a pot of tea for two, and it arrived dead on two. I should have known what it was going to be like when I pressed the bell at reception. They played Colonel Bogey. I'll never forget the room, you know. It was decorated in early dust. Which is rather nice when you think about it. But I've got to be fair, we're coming up now to a hotel to exceed all hotels, and certainly a character who's going to sing Heartbreak Hotel. He's one of the stars of that great musical Elvis, and his name is Bogdan Komanowski.
Well, she's up for you, let me. Was happy and I'm on the street and I'll be good in love. I'm so lonely, baby. I'm so lonely. I'm so lonely, I can die. Although it's always crowded, you can soon have some room for broken hearted lovers to cry in the room. Well, I'm so lonely, baby. I'm so lonely. I'm so lonely, I can die.
Hiya, baby. All right, then?
Well, thank you very much. You know, Mr. Ted Rogers, sir, it's very nice being here. Looking forward to doing the show.
Now, listen, Bogdan, that's a great name. Bogdan Komanowski, and now that is what?
Polish.
Polish. Now, what are you leaving? What are you leaving for the clue?
I'm leaving, one of these.
A broken heart,
huh? A broken heart, yes.
A broken heart is the clue. Mm-hmm. Polish, but you're not really from Poland, are you?
Well, my father's French. My mother's Polish. Born in Germany, raised in New Zealand.
A bit of a mongrel, really, isn't he, really? Great to have you here. Now, listen, Bogdan, what about this rhyme for Chris
yes,
and Rosemary?
Yes, here we go. With five plus a king, you can go a la carte. Once you get in, it won't break your heart.
There you go. Now, what does that mean to you?
King.
A king. What do they think? You've got to be fair. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you. Bogdan Komanowski. Thank you, Bogdan. Good luck. Thanks, mate. So what do you think? You're having a good chat there. What do you reckon?
We're not sure at all.
Well, you've got to think about it after our next sketch, because then we're going to have three on the table. Now, there are all sorts of hotels, and of course the most famous is a typical British seaside boarding house. I stayed at one last week, and the advert said, from your room you can hear the sound of the breakers. And they were right. It was next to a scrapyard. I'll never forget the way they used to serve you tea in bed. It wasn't cold. Well, if it had been any colder, it'd have been on a stick. Now, please, you stay there. I'm sure you must have done. The landlady was so mean with her portions, too. You know, at one tea time, she even made ham sandwiches and the vegetarians were eating them. She used to overbook her room as well, you know. Oh, yeah. When she told you you had to be in bed by 10, she wasn't kidding. But don't take my word for it. Check it for yourself at this boarding house.
There you are, then.
Thank you.
It's all right. Oh, good morning. Can I help you?
My name is Stop. I have a complaint.
Oh, well, if it's catching, you can't stay here.
I wish to complain. I booked a room.
Oh, well, that's not my fault. You booked it.
And when I booked it, they told me this place was 2 minutes' walk from the station. It's taken me 20.
Well, it is 2 minutes' walk from the station. The police station.
Why on earth would I want the police station?
Oh, you haven't stayed here before, then.
No, and it doesn't look at all like the brochure. Where is the beautiful oak panel bar?
Ah, there you are.
It says here that drinking is not allowed in the sun lounge, billiard room, or library. You don't seem to have any of them.
That's why you can't drink in them.
What about the indoor pool?
Oh, yes, now that is inaccurate.
You haven't got an indoor pool?
Not since we had the roof fixed, no. But if you wish to take a bath while you're staying here, we do have an arrangement with that very nice hotel next door. You go and sing on their front steps at 3 a.m. and the night porter throws you in the sea.
It says here you recently put a shower in every room.
Oh, we did, yes. But the hotel inspector complained of overcrowding.
You haven't even got a bathroom?
In a word, no.
Then how can you possibly justify this bit here about catering for all creature comforts?
Well, we got quite a lot of creatures here and not one of them's ever complained.
This is quite appalling. I shall not stay another minute in this disgusting dump. I shall go to the hotel next door. Good day.
You can please yourself.
Hello, Mavis. Have you been busy?
Oh, hello, dear. No, not really. Oh, wait a minute. Now, and Mr. Stock telephoned to say he couldn't make it, so he'd have to cancel.
Dear, people are the end, aren't they?
I know, they are.
Anyway, thanks for standing in for me.
That's all right, dear. Any time. After all, I am only next door, and I?
Yes.
Hey, Sheila, lovely to see you. Now, what are you leaving as the clue?
That is a red herring.
Oh. So you've got a good chance straight away there, haven't you? Yeah. Nice to see you, Sheila, as usual. Now, let's see, where have you been lately? Anywhere good?
Well, I've just come back from Oslo, actually.
Working in Oslo?
Yes, I did a television show there. Really? It was great fun because everybody said, oh, don't worry, when you go to Oslo, every other person speaks English. Mm-hmm. Or when you go to Norway. I met every other person, the ones that
did. Now then, Sheila, have you got a rhyme, please, for Chris
yes,
and Rosemary?
Now, if you tackle the landlady when she comes to collect the rent and she throws you out, without a doubt, you'll be loitering with intent.
Now, it's decision time, folks. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, Sheila Burnett. Thanks so much. God bless you, ladies. Well, Chris, you've just heard that.
I can read
the heart again, yes. Or the piece of chalk which Anna Dorsa brought in. Which one would you like to hear?
We'd like the heart, please.
You'd like to hear the heart? Well, Bogdan brought this in. It said, with five plus a king, you can go a la carte. Once you get in, it won't break your heart. So, any ideas what it could be?
Oh.
Or what any of them could be? Because you now have to think about rejecting one. Which one's it going to be?
Which one shall we have?
Oh, I don't know.
The red herring.
We'll have the red herring.
Well, don't whisper.
We'll have the red herring.
Tell them all, they can all hear. You
want
to get rid of the red herring?
Yes,
all right, you're rejecting the red herring, which Sheila's just brought in. If you tackle the landlady when she comes to collect the rent and she throws you out without a doubt, you'd be loitering with intent. So, let's have a look and see what's inside here. Well, remember, the clue, of course, was a red herring. So are we trying to trick you? What do you think?
Maybe.
Well, we said tackle and loitering with intent, and that's what you would have won. A camping trailer. Oh. Right, come and have a look over here, Rosemary and Chris. Yes, look at what you've turned down here. A camping trailer. Look how large it is in there.
Fantastic.
But not just that. Do you like fishing at all?
Ah, I used to do a lot.
Well, look at that fishing tackle you've got there. Everything, the boots. And just in case, Chris, you didn't catch anything, we've laid on some smoked salmon there as well. Just have a good look at it and think about it, because you have rejected it, unfortunately. Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going away just for a short time. We'll be back soon with more prizes like this on 3-2-1. Don't go too far now. Part three, ladies and gentlemen, where Rosemary and Chris from Lincoln have just rejected a camping trailer, terrific prize, and of course a lot of fishing equipment. But that's the way it goes. We're going to have another sketch right now. You know, when you talk about hotels, you can't help thinking about Spain, because the Spanish have a marvelous way of getting you to know the locals. It's called working alongside the builders, helping to finish a hotel. The Spanish have a reputation for building hotels, you know, when you're in them. Last year on the Costa Brava, I stayed at a hotel, and the brochure said bathroom with H&C. Not hot and cold, hammer and chisel. What a shambles that place with. I don't mind sharing a room, but not with a cement mixer. 400 of us went down to breakfast together. The ceiling collapsed. Honestly, you can have a lot of fun at a hotel, especially in the dining room, as our next sketch will show you.
Leave it to me, madam. The lady at table 18 has got laryngitis. She'll just signal when she wants the wine.
Good idea. I don't mind if I do join you. It's not good to dine alone, is it? I dine alone quite a lot, you know. Yes. Oh, you're having soup. Have you heard the joke about the fellow who finds a fly in the soup? Calls the waiter over. He says, "Waiter, there's a fly in my soup." And the waiter goes, "Thank you, sir. You've saved that fly from drowning." Oh, wine! I'm a connoisseur of wine, you know. Oh, yes. The wine is sour. Waiter, it's sour wine. How can you serve sour wine, waiter? What it needs is a little sugar, you see. In she goes. Down she goes, and then we give it a shaky, 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 shaky. It's all right. You needn't thank me. Shaky, 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 shaky. And then we just pour, you see. It's a little cloudy, but not sour. Oh, pork chop and vegetables and potatoes. Very good. But don't eat the mashed potatoes. Not till I show you how to get the lumps out of them. Yes. What you do is this. Get your hand like so. Place the potato in the center like so, then squeeze, and squeeze, and squeeze. No lumps! You see, you're amazed, aren't you? Oh, yes, amazed. Let me show you a little trick now the Albanians use to make their meat more tender. You know, vulture meat can be pretty stringy stuff, you know. What they do is this. They take the pork chop and they put it in their left shoe. The left shoe is important. Not the right shoe, the left shoe. And then they do the left-footed Albanian pork chop dance. Mata Mandugo! Mata Mandugo! Wagaga! Mata Kandugo! Mata Kandugo! Bodigaga! That's it, you've got it now, you've got it. Oh, good. No, 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 that's not quite the idea.
Mala Malugu. Mala Malugu.
Listen now, Chad, I'm leaving a cup of tea.
A cup of tea?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
And I have I have here for the people a pork chop. No, no.
Is that the vulture meat?
That's the vulture meat. No, I have a clue here, I think, somewhere hidden away. Here we go, my friends. Chris and Rosemary. This is the rhyme. With no waiting, you could be in trouble if you give the wrong signal to me. But I can be of service if I take away the tea. Dun, 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 dun.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mike Newman. Thank you, Mike.
Take care.
Thank you, mate. Thank you. Oh. Okay, Rosemary, Chris, You just heard that from Mike. I can read you the heart, of course, which Bogdan brought in, and Anna Dawson brought in the piece of chalk, which was the first sketch. Which would you like to hear again?
I think we'll hear the chalk again.
Chalk again from Anna. Yes, she said, this could be the start of something. You may get carried away. If you're stopping at a four-star, you'll impress the staff this way.
I think it's a case of eeny, meeny, miny, moe.
Really? All right. So which one will you reject?
We'll throw out the tea.
A cup of tea that Mike's just brought in?
Yes.
Looks like it's been thrown out.
Yes.
You're definite about that? You want to get rid of it?
Quite.
All right. Okay, let's see what it says. Mike just said, with no waiting, you could be in trouble if you give the wrong signal to me, but I can be of service if you take away the tea. So let's see. Well, we said you could be in trouble if you gave a wrong signal. Well, you certainly would be in trouble. A car, if you parked it where it said no waiting. The key word was trouble. Mike said he could be of service if he took away the tea. So what would you have if you left? What would you say?
Rubble.
Right, the tea from trouble is rubble, and you've rejected Dusty Bing. Oh, yes! Come and have a look at it. What did you say, Rosemary, as he came in then?
Oh.
He's lovely. That's right. They all say it, but you're so delighted to see the back of him, right?
Yes.
I think so.
Still
he's been rejected once again. The poor old Dust, take him away, Karen. Off he goes. We'll see you next week. Off you go. Right. Okay, now you know you're out of trouble, right?
Yes.
You're going to take on something very, very good tonight. Right, so now we're going to have our last sketch, you know. It's about one of those quaint old country houses. Let's go there now and meet some of the local characters.
Hey, George, you have that one on me.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon.
Afternoon. Been playing tennis, have you?
I beg your pardon?
Tennis?
If you're referring to my attire, I'm an ornithologist.
A horny what?
An ornithologist. I watch birds.
Oh, yeah.
Birds, my man, the feathered kind. Now, I'd like a drink, please, and a snack.
Oh, certainly, sir, certainly. What would you like? A bowl of water and some millet?
Yes, it's very droll. I'll have a gin and tonic, please, and I suppose you'd better have one for yourself.
Oh, that's very kind of you, sir. Thank you. Cheers, cock. What the hell was that?
What was what?
That noise.
You noticed, did you?
Yeah, was it you? Yeah, I don't allow no singing in this place, you know.
I'm sorry, it was just that when you said, you know, C-O-C-K.
What, cock? You did it again.
Yes, well, I'm sorry, but it's a sort of affliction.
Affliction?
Yes, probably from all the years I've spent in the woods and things watching birds. I get a sort of compulsion every time somebody mentions the name of a bird or even an animal sometimes.
Oh, I see. Have you seen a vet about that? I reckon it could be a bit embarrassing.
Yes, it is.
Makes you feel a bit of a cuckoo, does it, sometimes? Yeah. Pardon?
You did that on purpose, didn't you?
Yes, sorry about that. I was just testing. I only did it for a lark.
I wish you'd stop doing that.
I bet all this makes you a little hoarse, doesn't it? You're very versatile, I'll say that for you. Here, what's your wife think about all these impressions?
Well, she's got used to it by now.
Oh, you don't fight like cat and dog, then? I bet he gives her plenty to crow about. At end parties.
You are doing this on purpose. I'm leaving.
You got a fly, have you?
Yes, it's most amusing.
Mind your head on the way out. You may have to duck. I'm sorry about that. I forgot to tell you, the duck hunting season started today.
Yeah. Andrew Sachs, that's what you're leaving, is it, as
that's
the clue?
Yes, that's the clue.
Nice to have you with us, Andrew.
Nice to be here.
Everybody, of course, knows you from the marvellous Fawlty Towers.
Ah.
Hey, now, you really went through something with Basil, didn't you, throughout the whole of that stint? Now, was there anything you would have loved to have done when it actually finished?
Well, there was one gag I'd like to have done.
When was that?
Yes.
Well, if I'm Manuel and you're Basil, yes?
Yes.
But the gag I'd like to have done was,
Hey, Manuel!
Yeah.
Ah! Now, listen, have you got a clue for these people in the rhyme?
Yeah.
I thought you said you were Manuel, not Kay.
Right, this is the clue. If this clue leaves a good impression, we could only wish you luck, because if you go in for a session, will you be out for a duck?
Now then.
Quack.
Quack, quack. Yes, indeed. Don't make him do another one of those noises. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you. Andrew Sachs. Thanks, Andrew. Thank you very much. Yes. Right. Okay, you've just heard that. I can read you Anna Dawson's piece of chalk again, or once again, Bogdan's Broken Heart. Now, they've stayed on the table all the way through, haven't they, those two?
Yes. I think we'll hear the chalk again.
The chalk once more. First sketch, Anna. She said, this could be the start of something. You may get carried away. If you're stopping at a 4-star, you'll impress the staff this way.
We'll reject the feather.
Quill. Oh, the feather.
The quill. Yes, please.
Okay, the feather or the quill from Andrew Sachs. He said, if this clue leaves a good impression, we could only wish you luck. Because if you go in for a session, will you be out for a duck? Will you? Let's have a look. Okay, if you were after a duck, what would you go into for a session? Any idea?
Shooting hide.
Well, no, you'd go in water. Oh, and what better way than in this beautiful Enterprise boat? Now, come and have a look at this. There it is, complete with trailer, launching trolley, outboard motor, and two life jackets in case you got into trouble. But it's a fantastic price. Not quite the camera equipment, was it?
No,
not quite the camera equipment.
It's terrific. Fellas, Annie, I'm afraid it has to go. Off it goes, it's been rejected.
Hard luck, Chris.
Yes, indeed, it is make your mind up time. You've got the last two. They've stayed on the table the whole show, right? So I'll read you again, Anna. She brought this in, the piece of chalk. This could be the start of something. You may get carried away. If you're stopping at a 4-star, you'll impress the staff this way. Bogdan Komanowski said, with 5 plus a king, you can go a la carte. Once you get in, it won't break your heart. So, what do you reckon?
Well, I think...
I mean, after that.
I know.
I think the chalk.
That might be a holiday.
Holiday of some sort.
Yes, and what do you think the heart might be?
Well, we think it just might be a car.
Really?
Yes.
So?
With the V registration.
Well,
registration.
I've said that once before. So what do you think?
Go on,
it's up to you.
We'll take that one and we'll throw that one away.
Throw
you reckon so, Rosemary? You reckon that's okay?
Yeah.
Let's see what it is. Okay. This could be the start of something. You may get carried away. If you're stopping at a 4-star, you'll impress the staff this way. Well, if you're stopping at a 4-star, you'll impress the staff this way. Could that be a garage or a hotel? Well, we mentioned carried away, and that's what would happen to this 8-piece set of luggage. Oh. Don't have a look at that. Look at that. Just feel that. That is absolutely fantastic. That is the tops you can get. I can't mention the name, you know that, but that really is incredible stuff. And I can tell you there is £1,000 worth there. It is unbelievable, Rosemary, but it's been rejected, so let's see what you're taking home with you tonight. Take it away, fellas. Bye-bye, Lorraine. The broken heart. Is it going to be a broken heart? Well,
it's not the dustbin, we know.
You know that. Okay, let's see. With 5 plus a king, you can go a la carte. That's it, hold a hand. Once you get in, it won't break your heart. Now then. Well, the key was a la carte, which is French.
Yes.
And 5 in French is what?
Sank.
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 Yeah. Well, as for the king, we thought of George, and the song Bogdan sang was Heartbreak Hotel. We'll put them all together. What do you think
George
that could be?
Hotel in Paris.
That's right. You've won 7 nights at the George Sank Hotel in Paris. Yes. Tower, look at that. Marvellous place. And I tell you what else goes in with this. You're getting breakfast, a la carte dinner every evening, And there'll be one night at a famous Paris night spot with champagne to help you celebrate. Now, you delighted with that?
See?
Very nice. Wonderful. Okay, and here is Mireille. Mireille is here with your holiday vouchers. And that's not Blackpool, that's the Eiffel Tower. I can tell you that. You really pleased with us?
We are.
There you are. Well, congratulations to you, Chris. Congratulations, Rosemary. Haven't they been a friendly couple, folks? Well, there you are. That's right. We're back next week. More fun, more lovely people. 3, 2, 1. See you next Friday. Good night, everybody.